I hope you have your Bibles with you, because I'm going to be sharing some things with you that are basic to understanding the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Now, I'm not going to get into tongues and interpretation and all that, not yet. There will come a time. I have two of these Wednesday nights next month, and so I'll be doing it then. But I want to set some basic things tonight, and I want you to see them in the Word with me. First of all, let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 8. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, and I approach, when I'm ministering to you, I approach this with some trepidation. That's a big word for fear, trepidation, and because I'm not a great scholar. I think you've got that a bit exaggerated when some of you talk. I'm not a great scholar. I've just had a chance to spend a considerable amount of time in being in the ministry for 55 years and having sermons every week and studying and preparing. Loved it and just ate the Word. And I love the Word of God since I was 16 years old and I gave my heart back to Christ. I got saved when I was 10, but that's when I started attending church. And I used to ride my bicycle to church, 2-3 miles to church, and singing all the way, wonderful words of life. Sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. And I just grew up with a love for the Word. And so I trust the Holy Spirit tonight. You know, whatever I have to say about the Word is not what you're going to remember, I hope. But I trust the Holy Spirit to take the seed of the Word of God and put it in each of our hearts so that we will hear what the Spirit of God is saying. Some of it will be very basic, but let's look first of all at 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 2. And here he says, "And if any man think that he knoweth anything, he knoweth nothing yet as he ought to know." I'm very apprised of that fact, that even whatever I might have learned and God might have blessed me with, it's nothing yet compared to what I should know. And I want to say something to you people that are a little more advanced in years like I am, that it's never too late to learn more about the Lord Jesus Christ. Because we can be constantly learning and growing and knowing Him better every day that goes by. And I like it better now to know that my days are numbered, because it makes me want to use those days as wisely as I can and getting to know Him as well as I can. My hero, one of my earthly heroes, was Joshua Chamberlain. And Joshua Chamberlain said when he was in his 80s, "I want to spend the rest of my life getting to know God better." Amen. And that's a goal of mine. So I will share with you that I do not have all the answers, and I have much to learn. And I'm so thankful for what little bit He has shown me now, and I look forward to learning even more. So if you'll turn over a few pages to chapter 12 of 1 Corinthians, you know, the one thing we do not want to be, we do not want to be contented where we are. Now, it's nice to be contented with what we have. The Lord tells us to be contented with what you have. But He never gives us the feeling that we should be contented where we are. In the things of the Spirit, contentment is lethal. As we sit back and say, "Now I can relax, I've got it all I know. Don't talk to me about any more, because I now have enough that I know I don't want any more." Oh, if you got that, kick it right out. Don't even think that way. Because there's so much more that He wants to reveal to us, as the Word of God says in chapter 2 of 1 Corinthians, where He says, "And it has not entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love Him." So there are things that haven't entered into my heart yet, and things that haven't entered into your heart yet. And so let's be open. There's a whole thrilling treasure chest of God's grace, who said, "How He that gave us His only begotten Son, how shall He not also with Him freely give us all things?" There are treasures yet to be, but He can't give them until we're old enough to handle them. And so we're always keeping an attitude of learning and learning. And in 1 Corinthians 12, verse 1, He says, "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant." Now, this was written by the Apostle Paul, and there's one thing that we need to realize, that the desire of God's heart and the ministry of the Apostle Paul was, "I want you not to be ignorant," and it's not gifts. That word is put in there in the King James Version. It is really, and I'm not trying to impress you, but it sounds nice, pneumatica, which just means spiritual things. He says, "And regarding spiritual things, I don't want you to be ignorant." And I don't want to be ignorant either. So I said, "That's good, Paul, you and I agree. Let's learn together here." And then in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 4, just taking a look at that, and I approach every time I minister, I approach with this in my mind and in my heart. Verse chapter 2, verse 4. And he says, "And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of men's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and power." Yes. Hallelujah. Amen. Demonstration. See it. Experience it. The reality of it. And so if we open our eyes and open our hearts, surrendering our wills to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, that's when the Spirit of God can begin to open things up to us. And it's just amazing how he just keeps dropping wonderful words of wisdom to us that we never had before. I hate to think about when I was so young in the ministry, that, Lord, I just don't know how you could have used me at all. I was so young, so inexperienced, so stupid, made so many mistakes, and yet he says, "But I called you to be my servant." So, thank the Lord, we do not have to be, we don't have to shut ourselves up and turn ourselves off because we are young and stupid and don't know everything. But he says, "Hey, I've chosen you. A servant is chosen, and he's chosen by the Lord." So no matter wherever you are, you can always serve the Lord. And as I get older, I think, getting older. I don't feel old yet, but I think I'm getting older, and I begin to realize what a privilege it is just to be whatever he wants us to be, wherever he wants us to be, doing whatever he wants us to do. Amen. And nothing else. That is enough. And the highest accolade, or this, like the Freedom Medal or the Medal of Honor, the highest one we can get is for him to say, yes. "Well done.
Yes.
How good?
Yes.
And faithful."
Yep, that's right.
What's the word?
Right.
Servant. See? Servant. All right. Now, there are, when we talk about gifts of the Spirit, I want to realize there's so much that people do not know. I didn't know beans from apple butter about Pentecostals, and that was good, because when the Lord poured out his Spirit upon us, I didn't know where to go except to the Word of God. And I discovered a lot of things in the Word of God that weren't being done in Pentecostal circles. I understood there were a lot of things being done in Pentecostal circles that weren't in the Word of God. And so as a Baptist who knew only the Word of God, it was a good book to follow. And you know, the Lord gave us a wonderful time of growing in grace. That's the operative power of God. Growing in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And things being done decently and in order. Now, when I talk about gifts, there are different words that are called gifts. You know, that word is stretched way out of shape. And if we understand what we're talking about, it'll help us when we pray. It'll help us when we listen. It'll just help us when we minister. And there were gifts that were given to men. That's what I'm going to talk about tonight. What are the ones that were just given to men? And I think it'll surprise you. Then there were gifts that were given to the church. Not to men, but to the church. And then there were, they call them gifts, which are really manifestations of the Holy Spirit through the ministers of the church to the body of Christ, that they might grow and mature. And so tonight I'll start with the gifts that were given to men. So if you have your Bibles open, let's turn together to the Gospel of John, chapter 4, verse 10. I'm using a different Bible tonight because my other one is, it's getting like me. It's getting old, and I have to be careful when I turn the pages because they tear, and it's getting brittle. But I got so much in it, I can't stand to read anything else but just that one and all the notes that I put in over the years. All right, look at chapter 4, verse 10. And Jesus, answering the woman at the well, he said, he talks to her, and he said unto her, "If you knew the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldst have asked him, and he would have given thee living water." See, if you knew the gift of God. Now, this word, and you might want to just write it on a piece of paper. It's really not hard. Usually I have something, and then I write it in the Greek, and then it's always impressive to people, you know. But this, we're not interested in impressing people. But the word is D-O-R-E-A, Doreum. And that word is gifts in the New Testament. One of the three words, Doria. In fact, it's a word that some people name the little girl children, Doria. How many of you have heard that name? Anybody use it? Doria? It means a gift from God. And so when we use this word, Doria, it refers to a person. And so Jesus is saying to the woman, if you knew Doria, and they would understand the person, that I am the gift. John 3:16 comes to mind. For God so loved the world that he gave, what did he give? His only begotten Son. See? And so the first thing we understand about gifts is, and this is the gift that's given to all men. All men may receive it. You know, women too. But all people may receive it. The gift of the Lord Jesus Christ. And what a great gift. And I'll find you another scripture in a moment. In Romans chapter 5, verse 25. And I can remember when I was a first Christian, and I had to learn how to find these books. We did sword drills and everything to be able so we could read and open up a book. It wasn't on the wall for us. And but I want you to look at it in the Word of God. This is Romans chapter 5, and it's verse 15. And here we find that Paul saying, but not as the offense of the sin, so also is the free gift, the free doria. And he says, for if through the offense of one many were dead, much more the grace of God, the operative power of God, and the doria by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. And so using that word doria, we know that he's talking about the gift is the gift of a person, and the person is the Lord Jesus Christ. And let us never forget the gift of God. You know, I pray the Holy Ghost will impress upon you as well as me, you know, the joy of our salvation, the appreciation for a gift that is beyond expression, as we read in another verse in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7. And this is the gift of Jesus Christ, Ephesians 4, verse 7. And here we read, All right. But unto every one of us is given grace, the operative power of God, according to the measure of the doria of Christ. We get the grace of God through that gift, that person, the Lord Jesus Christ. And then one more verse, 2 Corinthians 9:15. 2 Corinthians 9:15. Here we go. And we read here, thanks be unto God for his unspeakable doria. You cannot put into words what Jesus Christ, the gift of God, who so loved the world that he gave us his Son. How are you going to describe in words for such a gift? And that's why I like to hear people say, we ask for testimonies. Unless you've had a near-death experience or something, you think you don't have a testimony. But how many of you have got the gift of the Lord Jesus Christ? And I think to be able to stand up and say, I want to thank God for the unspeakable gift, that there is not enough words that I could put in. And you know, you've got to meditate on that a little bit, or otherwise you don't have a testimony. And as I understand and watch in churches today, that most of the people don't have a testimony. They put it on the shelf, it's gathered dust, and you got to go and really clean it off. Oh, God, help us that we clean it off, that our lives will be filled with the joy of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when we realize all he's done, and you know, when you're old like me, you can look back over a life and see how many times that the operative power, the grace of God, was given to you through the person of Jesus Christ and what it means. The way to grow in God is to remember God. The way to grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord is to keep in mind the things that he has done for you. Remember the children of Israel? Boy, they were getting along just fine. Everything is going great, but the Bible says they soon forgot his works. And then they grew cold and they had leanness into their souls. And I don't want to be a lean Christian. Don't want to be a fat Christian either, but I want to be filled with the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. His unspeakable gift. Now you got to stir that in you. The Bible tells you to stir up the gift of God in you. You can't just say, oh, I'm waiting for the Lord to fall on me. He won't. He's waiting for a sincere and open heart to say, God, please, I want to know you. I hunger and thirst after you, Lord. And he has given you a promise, and you shall be filled. It's nice to be filled with Jesus Christ. There's another verse. It's a verse I've memorized. It's part of my prayers each morning. that says, Paul is praying, says, for this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, and that you may know, wait a minute now, in your heart, and you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now, my scripture verse it. How does that go? Somebody else know that? It's in chapter 3 of Ephesians. Anyway, he's saying, that's okay. My mind is not what it used to be, but still in pretty good shape. The thing is, he says, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you may, rooted and grounded in love, you may be filled with all the fullness of God, and that you may comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ that passeth knowledge. And looking that up in other translations in the original language, it means that passeth knowledge means that it goes beyond. I said, how can we know something that passes knowledge? And he says, and the Lord just spoke to me, revealed it to me. He says, it means that when it passes knowledge, it goes from up here into your experience and into your life. It's the love of Christ that goes into your experience. It's beyond just a mental knowledge. And so I think about that and say, that's a good testimony to be able to do that. Well, anyway, so at this point, in 2 Corinthians 9:15, thanks be unto God for his unspeakable. Unspeakable means there are no words. Really, all the words that you use are not enough to express Jesus Christ and the wonderful gift of God that he's given us. He took our sins away. You know, all those things that I look back and say, I don't like to think about them. You know, this is before I met my wife. You know, but he took them all away. They're gone. And then I can say today, the devil has no place in me, no power over me, no unsettled claims against me. All has been settled by the blood of Jesus. All right. Now, the word Doria is also used with another person. Can you guess who that might be? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not an influence. He is a person. There was a man in just north of Dayton, Ohio, who had a whole campus up there, kind of like a crazy university. But he taught people that he went. I got his book and a whole list of the references. And every time in the Word of God where it speaks of the Holy Spirit, it's talking about the person. But when it just uses the words Holy Spirit, that means that some kind of an influence that comes upon you. Well, Dumbo, in the English language and other languages, the absolute nouns do not always need a definite article. And when you say, you don't say, if you say God or the God, does it make any difference between the two? Why? Because it's an absolute. You can say, it's just theos, that means God. If you say Tom Theos, that says God. And his name was Dr. I don't know where he got the doctorate, you know, but witch doctor, I think. But anyway, in his doctorate, he taught people, if you come up to him and he costs you $75 and you'll be guaranteed to be filled with the Holy Ghost, you know. And old poor people, they just suck that up, you know. I'm amazed at the gullibility of people sometimes. But we used to call him Weird Willie. His last name was Weird Will. But anyway, I'm going to talk about the person of the Holy Spirit. He is a person. He has speech. He speaks. He thinks. He loves. All of these things. He does everything that personality can do. And I want you to look with me at where the word Doria is used in reference to the Holy Spirit. If you'll start out, these are all in the book of Acts, so you'll not be having to run very far in your Bibles. Start out with Acts chapter 2:38. Acts chapter 2:38. And here we read, Then Peter said unto them, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the Doria of the Holy Ghost. The person of the Holy Ghost. He's not an influence. Acts 2:38. This one reminds me that, because you may remember this verse after I tell you this, that this man broke into this woman's house. And as he broke in, he was busy, and But she had called the police, and as they got there, suddenly he's running away and running out of the house as fast as he can. They caught him and said, "How come you ran away?" He said, "I don't know, but that old gal up there said she had an axe and two .38s. Because she kept yelling, "Axe 238, axe 238. She got an axe and 238s, and I didn't want to mess with that. All right. But, thank you. You must have a little bit of English blood in you. It takes a little bit longer to get through. All right. But the fact is, the Holy Spirit is a person. Hallelujah. Wonderful. And you never appreciate it. I can remember when a man came and knocked on my house door one Sunday. I think you heard me say this before. Funny looking little man. No, he's a big man, but funny looking. He had on a funny little hat. And a man that I assessed right away, being the great big smart guy I was, being on the faculty of Purdue University, you know, what do you know? And he had the effrontery to wake me up on a nap on Sunday afternoon. Now that's verboten. And anyway, he asked me, I opened the door and I looked at him, and his words of greeting were, "Have you got the Holy Ghost?" And I looked at him and said, "You woke me up from a nap to ask me that?" I admit I wasn't very pleasant with him. But you know, God used him. It's amazing what God uses. And he can get through any heart, I'm telling you. But he finally, after talking back and forth, he says, "Well, yeah, I've got the Holy Spirit." He says, "Well, no," he said, "that's not what I'm talking about, but the Holy Spirit." And I could see he was Pentecostal, and they sometimes look at it a little differently than I do and I think the scriptures do. But he said to me, he said, "God is really doing something today, and you should get in on it." I was 34, 35 years old. And I said, "Oh boy, if God was doing anything anywhere, I'd like to get in on it. He's not doing anything here." And in that church that I was pastoring, I really used to go behind the baptistry on Sunday morning before I came out. I said, "God, I don't want to go out there today." I said, you know, it was like plowing mud, you know, it just not going to get anywhere, plowing sand. But anyway, I went out, but I couldn't get that out of my mind, that you ought to get in on it. And I thought, "Boy, where are you doing anything, Lord?" Well, he left me with some magazines, and I went down to St. Louis, and that's when I got filled with the Holy Ghost. And then I became one of them. Well, actually, now let's look at chapter 8, verse 20. 8 to 20. But then I began to realize there was more that the Holy Ghost could do. I'll tell you one thing about that, folks. I don't know where some of you stand on it. I know I can warn you, if you are filled with the Holy Ghost and you just set it on the shelf, you know what the Lord said to when he gave the talents, 5 and 10 and 1, the guy that had one, he just went and hid it. And you know, the Lord didn't say to him, "Well, that's okay," son. He said, "You wicked and slothful servant."
That's right.
And I'll tell you, when you got the Holy Ghost, you don't hide it. If you do, bad things happen. Because I've seen bad things happen to people. So don't be afraid. Don't worry what man thinks of you. That's when there is a liberty in the spirit where we don't give a hoot and a holler what people think of us. As long as I know I'm in the will of God. And I've made some dumb mistakes there. I remember the Spirit of God moved on me to prophesy in the minister's meeting. And I didn't. I didn't want to bring dissension. Oh boy, the Lord didn't care a snap for my attitude on that one. And he just didn't let me prophesy for a long time after that. So don't resist. And whatever the Holy Spirit tells you to do, do it. He didn't give it to you to just look at and be on a shelf and look at once in a while. I say there's a number of closet charismatics in this church, and I think they should come out of the closet. And you say, "Well, people didn't like it." So what? Who are we pleasing? And I'll tell you one thing. As I said, Paul, when he came, he says, "I came unto you in the demonstration of the Spirit and power." The demonstration. All right. Now, look at chapter 8, verse 20. And here we read, "But Peter said unto him," he's talking to this Simon the sorcerer, you know. He saw the Holy Spirit being given to people. And man, they were evidently speaking in tongues and prophesying and whatever people do when they're filled with the Holy Ghost. And he saw them praying, so he figured, he dealt in witchcraft. And so he looked at them and said, "Boy, I mean, this is a good one. I mean, I can make a lot of money on this one." Now, I'll ask them, so he went to the apostles and says, "Give me this power not the Holy Spirit. Give me the power that when I pray for people, they'll also receive the Holy Spirit. Because I could charge them $75. Just like we really did. But the fact is, when Simon saw that through the laying of the apostles' hands, the Holy Ghost was given, he offered the money. Give me also this power that on whomsoever I lay hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost. But Peter said unto him, your money perish with you, because thou hast thought that the gift of God, and what do you know what that was? Doria. The person of the Holy Ghost could be purchased with money. And another one next, chapter 10. That's when Peter went to the household of Cornelius. I like this story. And it's in verse 45. And where are we here? Okay. And as he preached, verse 44, while Peter yet spake these words, what words were those? He just preached the old gospel to them. He was just telling them how Christ died for their sins, buried, rose again the third day. Told them they needed to repent and believe. While he was talking, the Holy Ghost fell on all them. Now, when you read in the Bible, many times the Holy Ghost is described as falling on them. Boy, it's my prayer that the Holy Ghost is going to fall on this church some Sunday.
Amen.
Just fall. Pardon me. Just fall. All right. Well, anyway, it said in 45, as he goes on, he says, and they of the circumcision, as he was talking to them, they were there and they believed. These were the Jews. And they looked at him and said, look at what is happening. For because on the Gentiles also was poured out the doria of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
And here are these Jews that looked at them and said, well, if God pours out the Holy Ghost on these Jews, they're okay. Just like us, we had to receive the Holy Ghost. By the word, I use that receive. When a person gets born again, the Holy Spirit does come and live within him. That is the seal. That is the seal of your redemption. That's the proof that you got what you asked for when you believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. But after that, after Pentecost, anytime the book of Acts uses the word they received, it's always related to the baptism in the Holy Spirit with tongues, interpretation, and all that. Now, we'll talk about that some at a later date. But and then one more in Acts 11:17. Just turn over, and this is where I believe Peter is giving an account of what happened at Cornelius' house, 11:17. And we read, now while Peter doubted in himself, whoops, wait a minute, it's not, I've got Acts 11:17. I was looking at 10:17, or 11:17. For as much then as God gave them the like doria, he did, as he did unto us who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, what was I that I could withstand God? Sometimes the religious leaders say, well, you know, you shouldn't be doing that, and say, I'm not doing it. God's doing it. I had an experience in one of the churches here in Kokomo that I was on the staff, and I would pray for people sometimes. They'd come up. When I pray for them, they'd go down like somebody shot them. Now, that's not a gift that God gave me. That's just the way he wanted to express his presence and what he's doing. And sometimes he has to knock them down so they'll listen to him. Sometimes those people learn more while they're laying on the floor than they've learned all the time they were standing up. But anyway, I was praying, and down went a couple of them, and the pastor didn't like it. Well, we just don't want that here. I said, look, I'm not doing it. If you ask me to pray for somebody, you'll take whatever God does. I'm not doing it. But you know, sometimes a person who already thinks he knows all there is about it can't accept the fact that it's not the man that's doing it. It is God that's doing it. And he didn't say, certain of you that I've picked out, you go lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. He didn't. He said, he that believeth, let him lay hands on the sick and they will recover. All right. So now this word doria refers to two persons. One, the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, the wonderful, inexplicable gift of the Lord Jesus Christ, and then the gift of the Holy Spirit too, as he came on them. And usually these in the book of Acts are referring to that experience of the baptism in the Holy Ghost. You know, as a good Baptist Baptist born, Baptist bred, Baptist trained, and Baptist dead until I got filled with the Holy Ghost. And then it was just like the Lord set fire to all the doctrine that I had, and it began to live. Otherwise, it was just all ordered out there, and I knew what I believed. But there's a difference in just academically knowing it and experiencing it. God never intended for us to just have brains without any feelings and without a life in Jesus Christ. And everything, this book is not an end in itself. You know, I believe everything is supposed to be living, powerful, all of this, but it is really only the doorway to knowing Jesus Christ. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ from generation to revolution, Genesis to Revelation. And so when we come to the Word, we say, Lord, this is helping me to know you better. And that's what I want. Lord, I'm pretty handy with the Word of God. I know how to dissect it, how to read it in Greek and all this. But he says, yeah, but there's more. Paul said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. Don't ask to know him without knowing the whole of him and the identification with him, going outside and bearing the reproach of the cross that goes with it. Now, there is another word, and I've got time enough to deal with it. It is spelled D-O-M-A. Let's see, I gotta read it in the Greek. D-O-M-A-T-A. Domata. Domata. Say domata. Domata. So there's Doria tonight and Domata. Now, I never met anybody named Domata. I met some named Dodo, but never. There's one in the Bible named Dodo. But Domata. And this word refers to a certain number of gifts. And I want you to turn with me now to Ephesians chapter 4. And these are ministry gifts. Now, these are not given to people. They're given to the church. Now, the Lord uses people with these gifts. They minister. But these have to do basically with people that are called. Now, notice what they are. In chapter 4, and I got to look at my notes here. Chapter 8 and following, verse 8 and following. But he says in verse 8, wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. And that word gifts there is domata. It's funny, but God uses servants and ignorant people. And I remember, I don't know how many of you knew Dr. Harold Ockengay. If you lived on the East Coast, you knew Dr. Harold Ockengay, pastor of a big church in Boston. He was the president of the New England Association of Evangelicals. Actually, he's the one of the founders of it. And a tremendous expositor of the scriptures. Every time he'd preach, I'd just listen. I want to be like him, Lord. I want to be like him. You know, I just like the way he walked. I like the way he talked. I like what he said. But I saw him at a Baptist conference we had in Dayton. And we happened to be getting our coats at the same time. And I mentioned to him, I said, Dr. Ockengay, I said, you wrote a book on the church from the book of Ephesians. I said, you went through the book of Ephesians and Timothy, and I said, you dealt with the ministries of the church. And he said, I said, I want you to realize our church is a charismatic church. Well, he knew what I was talking about when I said that. And he says, oh, is that so? And I says, I want you to know that your book was so helpful to me in my preaching to guide the church in a good, sound relationship to the scriptures and things being orderly and right. And he said, well, thank you for telling me that. But I said, did you ever notice? I says, when it refers to the gifts, you didn't cover this in your book, but I said, one Greek word is used for the Holy Spirit referring to a person. And I said, and then when you read in Ephesians, I said, it's a different word for gift altogether. And it is limited just to the ministries. And he looked at me and said, no, I never noticed that before. Just think, I spoke to the great Dr. Howard Harold Ockengay and said something he hadn't seen before. But God has a way of showing even you and me things that he hasn't shown to the big men. He's got so much that he wants to let us know, and he'll drop a little diamond in our hearts and minds every once in a while. But these gifts were ministry gifts, and as we look at them again, he says in verse 11, he gave some apostles. Now, there are five here mentioned. I'll just recite them as you'll see. Apostles. Now, you watch here. I have a real illustration for you. It's like a human hand. Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. The apostle works well with all of the other four. The index finger is the prophetic finger. The apostle, the prophet, pointing out sin to the people, pointing out. The middle finger, used for many things these days, but as I was telling somebody, I tooted my horn to a woman that was asleep at the green light. I don't know how green it was supposed to be before she felt she could go out. But she just pointed toward heaven, but she was using her middle finger instead of the right one. But anyway, this is the evangelist. Now, it extends farther than the rest of the ministries do. And actually, my evangelist got shut in the door when I was a kid. He can only reach as far as my prophet. But then this one is the ring finger. Speaks as the pastor. It's his marriage, his commitment. And when a pastor goes to a church, he's married to that church. And then the little one, that's the teacher. The little one can often get into places that the others can't. So just remembering those. But notice what it says. These were gifts given to us. Why? I'm going to skip down here. Oh, verse 12, for the perfecting of the saints. But there's no comma in the Greek after that. Because it says, for the perfecting of the saints for the work of the ministry. It runs together. By the way, there are no commas in Greek, but it goes, for the perfecting of the saints for the work of the ministry. I know the church that didn't care for my teachings on or people falling down and things, they have a big sign. The gifts given for the perfecting of the saints, and it's all working for perfection. They spend all the time trying to get perfection. But it's perfection for the work of the ministry. And it is given to the church, why? To build up, verse 12, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith. Believing the right things together. Now, we may not agree on everything else, but we can believe on the right things together. And and come until that perfect man, or mature is what the word means. The Greek word teleon means maturity according to design. In other words, you're growing into what God wanted you to be and what he designed you to be. So it's the whole idea of building up the body of Christ. Now, your pastor is a gift of God to you. That's it. And God says, that's what I've got him for. I don't think you'll mind me running over 2 minutes. You can close your ears if you want to. But he is God's gift to his image church. As a result, we listen to him. And we pray for him that God will give this shepherd what his sheep need. Because God's church is not governed by a sheep committee. It's governed by a shepherd. Now, the shepherd leads. He doesn't drive. But as he leads by feeding the flock that they may grow and be edified in the ministry. That's what the pastor does. And we get a picture of what God thinks of people that got the idea, well, I don't think the pastor should be doing this. His name was called Korah in the Old Testament. Korah was a godly man. He was one of the elders in Israel. He got about 250 people together with him, and they came to Moses with a real spiritual thing. Well, you know, Moses, you really take too much on yourself now. You act like you're the only one that God speaks to, and he speaks to us too. And God says, tell you what I think of that. And he opened up the ground and swallowed them up. And God just didn't play around with people. He says, touch not mine anointed, he says, and do my prophets no harm. So I just leave that with you because it's a little bit thing. We're going to miss our shepherd for a month. And we've asked God, please bring him back. Yeah. Now, these ministries for the early church, and they continued on. They never stopped. And so when we talk about, that's as far as we can go tonight. And we really conclude with John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave. He gave his only begotten Son, and in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ have given to us the assurance and all the things we need to know our salvation and to grow in grace and in the knowledge of the Lord. And he's given to his body, the church. He's given to us made up of many members, different personalities. Many times I could say to somebody, boy, the church is just a wonderful place to work. It'd be great if it weren't for the people. The pastor's the one that usually gets focused on when things aren't going right. And it's like the school teacher that says, teaching is great if it weren't for the students. You know. But people are our business. People are our responsibility. And they are his responsibility. Not only will he bring to this church pastor, but the others too. Maybe someday an apostle will come through. They never passed away. There were 20-some apostles in the New Testament church. And then there are teachers of the word, people that are anointed of the Holy Spirit. We have to be careful when we select our teachers. Teachers that must be really spiritual men and women, because those are the ones that can minister the word of God to those in their charge. And then the teachers, then the other ones, evangelists. We often get the idea that the evangelist, primarily his outreach is farther than any of the others. He's a little bit more than someone that just preaches the gospel all the time, but he does that maybe more primarily than others, called to that. Praise God. Anybody got a question on what I've said tonight? That usually means one of two things. Either you understand basically what I was saying, or you had no idea what I was talking about. Yes, please. Yes. Special music. Let's see, how does it? God be with you till we meet. Sing it. By his counsel guide uphold you, with his flock securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet. At Jesus' feet, till we meet, till we meet. God be with you till we meet again. You're going to have to learn that one. At least once a month we're going to be singing it. God bless you. That's all for tonight.